When it comes to sorting algorithms, merge sort is one of the most efficient comparison-based sorting algorithms, and it's actually a pretty straightforward algorithm once you understand the intuition behind the sorting procedure. And in this tutorial, we will go over all the steps of the merge sort algorithm to understand the intuition behind it, after which we will implement the algorithm in Python and simulate that implementation on an example array of numbers. In the end, we will analyze the time and memory complexity to understand the pros and cons of using the merge sort in real life. The merge sort algorithm consists of two main parts. The first one is the part where we merge two sorted arrays into one sorted array. And the second part is where we recursively split the array into two parts and then merge those two parts together in increasing order. Let's go over each of those parts one by one. So the core idea behind the merge sort algorithm is the part that allows us to merge two sorted arrays into one sorted array in linear time. So given two sorted arrays, A and B, we need to figure out a way of merging those two into one sorted array in O of A plus B time, where A and B are the corresponding sizes of the arrays. You can pause the video and try to figure out how to do that yourself. And if you manage to come up with the algorithm of merging two sorted arrays into one yourself, then you've almost figured out the whole merge sort algorithm on your own. Okay, given these two arrays, we would like to merge those into a resulting array, which should be sorted in increasing order as well. To do that, we will have two pointers indicating which elements of the arrays are we processing right now. On each step, we will compare these two values and place the smaller one into the resulting array while moving the pointer of the smaller value forward. After that, we will compare the next two values. Notice that the pointer of the larger element doesn't move, and that ensures that we process elements one by one from the smallest to the largest. We will then move on to the next pair and continue populating the resulting array element by element, always picking the smallest one out of the current two. At some point, one of the pointers will move beyond the size of the array, and after that, we will be taking all the elements from the other array until both pointers move beyond the size of their corresponding arrays. That way, the resulting array will have all the elements of the two arrays in increasing order. The implementation follows exactly the steps we just described. We initialize the two pointers to indicate the first elements of the arrays, while also initializing the resulting array to be empty. As long as there are elements to process in any of the arrays, we iterate over the elements. We store the value of the first array in a variable if the pointer is still within the bounds of the first array. If it's not, we set it to infinity to indicate that the value cannot be part of the result. Similarly, we then store the value of the second array, after which we compare the values. And if the value of the first array is smaller than the one of the second array, we add the value to the result and increment the first pointer. Otherwise, we add the second value to the result and increment the second pointer. This way, the resulting array will have all of the elements from both arrays in increasing order. Notice that because we add each element to the resulting array only once, and adding one element to the result takes only one operation, the whole procedure takes all of A plus B time, where A is the size of the first array and B is the size of the second one. This ensures that the algorithm of merging two sorted arrays into one is highly efficient. We will come back to this implementation later. Now let's move on to the second part of the merge sort algorithm, which is the recursive step of splitting and merging the array. Let's keep in mind that we have a very efficient way of merging two sorted arrays into one, and we can use that in our work. So given the full array, we can recursively split the array into two parts until there is only a single or no elements left in the end. Having those parts sorted, we can start to merge the neighbor parts using our efficient merging algorithm. After that, we would move to the next neighbors and perform the recursive step again. We will repeat this process until the whole array is merged into one sorted sequence. To implement this part of the merge sort algorithm, we can define a function that, given an array, returns the sorted version of that array. If there is only a single element in the array or no elements at all, then the array is already sorted by definition, so we can just return the array and stop the function right there. Otherwise, we can sort the left half of the array and store the result in a separate variable, after which we can sort the remaining right half of the array and store the result in another variable. That would be the two recursive steps of the merge sort algorithm, after which we will have two sorted arrays representing the left and the right halves of the initial array. The only thing remaining is to merge those two sorted arrays into one. So we can use the merging algorithm we implemented before and return the resulting array. Putting all of this together, we will have two functions, one for merging two sorted arrays into one, and the other for recursively splitting and merging the parts to sort the whole array. Let's simulate the algorithm on this array to better understand how each step of the algorithm works and to form a better intuition around the inner workings of the merge sort algorithm. Starting with this unsorted array, we will first check if the length of the array is smaller than or equal to 1. And as it's not, we will split the array into two halves and call the merge sort function on each part separately. We will first call the merge sort function on the list 12, 3, 5, and executing the function, we will check if the length of the array is smaller than or equal to 1. And as there are three elements, we will proceed to the next operation, which further splits the array into two parts. That will first trigger a call to merge sort the first element of the array. Entering the function, we will check the length of the array, and seeing that it's equal to 1, we will stop the function there and return the array containing only one element. That will bring us back to the previous recursive call, where we needed to apply the merge sort function on two elements. As there are two elements, we would move on to recursively calling the merge sort function on each of those. The first call will result in returning the element right away, as the length of the array is just 1. The second call will result in returning the element as well, as the length of the array is 1 again. After that, we will need to merge these two arrays, so we will call merge function on 3 and 5. In the merge function, we will initialize the pointers to point to the first elements of the arrays and the result to an empty array. After that, we will start the while loop. We will initialize ai to the first element of the first array and bj to the first element of the second array. As ai is smaller than bj, we would add ai to the result and increment the first pointer. After that, we will initialize ai to infinity and bj to the first element of the second array. As ai is not smaller than bj, we would add bj to the result and increment the second pointer. After that, both pointers would be equal to the length of their corresponding arrays, so we will stop the while loop and return the resulting array, which would bring us back to the merge sort function, returning the merge result 3, 5. After that, the algorithm will move on to merging the array with the single element of 12 and the newly created array 3, 5. So we will call the merge function on those two arrays. Inside the merge function, we will first initialize the pointers and the result array and start the while loop. On the first iteration, we will set the value of ai to 12 and the value of bj to 3. As 12 is not smaller than 3, we will add 3 to the result and increment the second pointer. On the second iteration, we will set the value of ai to 12 again and the value of bj to 5. As 12 is not smaller than 5, we will add 5 to the result and increment the second pointer, moving it outside of the bounds of the second array. On the third iteration, the value of ai will be 12, while the value of bj will be infinity. As 12 is smaller than infinity, we will add 12 to the result and increment the first pointer. After checking the condition of the while loop, we will stop the loop and return the resulting array. This will bring us back to the very first recursive call of the merge sort, but the great thing is that we already have the left half sorted, so now we should sort the right half of the initial array. The program will start the execution of the merge sort on the second half of the array. As the length of the array is not smaller than or equal to 1, we will continue its execution. This will call the merge sort function on the two halves of the array, each one containing exactly two elements. We will proceed to executing the function call on the first half of the array, and as there are only two elements, the function will proceed to recursively call the merge sort function on the two elements separately. Entering the first call, as there is only a single element in the array, we will just return that element right away. After that, we will enter the second call, and as there is only one element in the array, we will return that element right away again. To complete that call, we will call the merge function on these two elements, so the program will call the merge function on 9 and 4. The merge function will perform its execution similar to the previous cases and will return the two numbers in the correct order. So we will have an array of 4 and 9 as the result of this execution. Moving forward, we will call the merge sort function on 1 and 7 separately. As there is only a single element in the array for both of these cases, the program will immediately return the array passed to it. So we will proceed to merge 1 and 7. This will result in 1 followed by 7, similar to how we merged 3 and 5 in one of our previous steps. This will bring us back to merging the two arrays, each one containing two elements. Now both of these two arrays are sorted in increasing order, so it's time to merge them into a sorted array containing four elements. The merge function will start by initializing the two pointers to zeros and the result to an empty array, after which we will enter the while loop. AI will be set to 4, while BJ will be set to 1. As 4 is not smaller than 1, we will add 1 to the result and increment the second pointer. During the next iteration, AI will be set to 4, while BJ will be set to 7. As 4 is smaller than 7, we will add 4 to the result and increment the first pointer. After that, AI will be set to 9, while BJ will be set to 7. As 7 is not smaller than 7, we will add 7 to the result and increment the second pointer. Finally, AI will be set to 9, while BJ will be set to infinity. As 9 is smaller than infinity, we will add 9 to the result and increment the first pointer. As both pointers are outside the array ranges now, we will stop the loop and return the resulting array. This will bring us back to the initial merge sort function call, but now both of the left and the right parts are sorted in increasing order. So the only thing remaining is merging those two into one. As a small practical exercise, try to write down all the steps of the merge function for the final step on a piece of paper yourself to see how we get the final sorted array. Let's now analyze the time and memory complexity for the merge sort algorithm. As we halve the array on each step, there are at most log n recursive halving operations that we can perform. If we look at each level of the branching for the merge sort algorithm, we can notice that each layer has at most n elements in there. As the merge function has a linear time complexity, the total time complexity for each level is O of n. Therefore, the time complexity for all the branching levels together is O of n times log n, making the total time complexity for the merge sort algorithm O of n log n. When analyzing the space complexity, we have to notice that the merge function stores the result in a completely new array. So for each level of branching, we have to store O of n additional memory. As that memory can be reused and cleaned up when performing the recursive calls on different levels, we can see that we never utilize more than O of n memory at any time. This results in a total memory complexity being O of n for the whole algorithm. It's important to note here that merge sort is an efficient comparison-based sorting algorithm, meaning that we sort elements by comparing them to one another. There are other algorithms like radix sort, for instance, that are not comparison-based and operate on numbers or digits directly, which can be more efficient in some cases, but have some limitations as well. We can apply the merge sort algorithm on any array of elements where we can compare the elements to one another, making the merge sort algorithm very versatile. So we can sort an array of strings, for instance. Yet with algorithms like radix sort or counting sort, there are many limitations that are caused by the inner workings of those sorting algorithms, making them applicable in only specific settings. To better master the merge sort algorithm, head to Profound Academy to solve hands-on problems with the link in the description. That will help to fully crystallize the knowledge. So this was it for the merge sort algorithm. Don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. Subscribe to see more tutorials like this. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.